All right, take out your Bibles this morning. Turn to 2 Kings, chapter number 6. 2 Kings number 6. As you're finding your way there, I want you to consider or think about, have you ever lost anything? Have you ever lost anything? Now, no doubt some of you right now are thinking, man, my mind, I sure missed that. We've all been there at some point in time or another. And I'm sure we have all lost something, you know, from time to time. Now, if you lost it somewhere other than home, you probably returned back to the place that you lost it. You know, hey, I was at this store, or I was, you know, at the hotel that I stayed in on my vacation, or I was at school or church. And maybe you return, or you call up and you ask them, hey, do you have a lost and found? And you know what the lost and found is, depending on the size of the place. It could be a box under a counter. It could be a table somewhere. Or it could be an entire room. Some places will have an entire room that is made up of lost and found. If you've ever looked through a lost and found section, though, it's crazy the things that you will find. You'll be looking through there and you'll think, how in the world does someone not know they lost this? Like it's one left shoe. I mean, were they walking around with just one shoe on and just didn't recognize that they were missing a shoe? You'll have a one left shoe. You'll have a sweatshirt. If it's after a lock-in at the church, you're going to have a pillow, a blanket, someone's shoes. You're going to have different things like that, a ball cap. Someone will leave a phone or a camera. You'll have in a lost and found this weird collection of stuff. I saw where a high school, their lost and found had grown so large, they ended up starting a thrift shop just with their lost and found stuff. And it was lost and found was able to keep the thrift shop going. In North Alabama, some of you are probably aware, I know in North Alabama there is a large store. They take the unclaimed luggage from airports that after they've been, you know, left at the airport for a certain amount of time and no one has claimed them, they go to this store in North Alabama where they sort through all the luggage. They sort out the different clothing items and different things. And so now they'll have a store, and then they also now are online. You can buy these things that other people have left their luggage in the airport. You can buy that stuff. I went online and started looking through that yesterday, and there's some nice stuff that people have left in their suitcase, this unclaimed luggage. If you want a $600 watch, you can get that on their site. If you want a new laptop, check out their site. There's all kinds of things in addition to all the clothing pieces that people have left in their luggage, and now it goes to lost and found and eventually goes to that store. Sometimes you don't have a lost and found to go through, though. Sometimes you lose something at home. Have you ever done that? And I know I had it at some point. Usually it's the remote control, right? You know, for us, it's kids. What did you do with the remote control? Where is it? I don't know. Well, how'd you turn the TV on? I don't know. It's here somewhere. And you know how it is. You'll turn the house upside down trying to find that one thing you lost. And then someone super helpful will come along and they'll ask you a question. Well, where'd you lose it? Well, listen, genius, if I knew where I lost it, I wouldn't be looking for it, would I? All right. If I knew where I lost it, it wouldn't be lost. I would know exactly where it was. But, you know, sometimes that can be helpful, because if you start thinking about where did I lose it, where did I last have it, where did I last see it, at least that gets you in the right direction, right? At least you start looking, okay, I remember I was in my bedroom, I had it, I went to the living room, and at some point I didn't have it. Okay, then I don't need to look in the kitchen because I just went from the bedroom to the living room. So it will kind of narrow down where you need to look. You know, there's times, though, that we lose something and there's no lost and found to go to. It's not in the house. Sometimes we lose something and we can't find it as easily. What if you've lost your joy? What if you've lost your peace? What if you've lost direction? Hey, what if you've lost your power or your love for God? What if you've lost yourself in all the mess that's going on around you? What if you've lost something that you can't just go find at the lost and found? This morning we're going to look at a story in 2 Kings chapter 6, just a few verses today. But it's a story of someone who lost something and how they found it again. So let's begin reading in 2 Kings chapter number 6. We're going to read verses 1 through 7. The Bible says, "And the sons of the prophets said unto Elisha, Behold now, the place where we dwell with thee is too strait for us. Let us go, we pray thee, unto Jordan, and take thence every man a beam, and let us make us a place there where we may dwell. And he answered, Go ye. And one said, be content, I pray thee, and go with thy servants. And he answered, I will go. So we went with them, and when they came to Jordan, they cut down wood. But as one was felling a beam, the axe head fell into the water, and he cried and said, alas, master, for it was borrowed. And the man of God said, where fell it? And he showed him the place. And he cut down a stick and cast it in thither, and the iron did swim. Therefore said he, take it up to thee. And he put out his hand and took it. You know, we see here in this just brief story, we see a man who lost something. And it was beyond his means to be able to recover it. And so he reached out to the prophet Elisha and said, Elisha, I need some help. Now, as by way of just a little bit of background and explaining this passage a little bit, you'll recognize here that what they call the sons of the prophets, this is kind of like ministry training or maybe what we would call Bible college. So it seems like there's some young preacher boys who are at Bible college, basically. And they've said, hey, Elisha, our dormitory is way too small for us. Like we're growing in attendance and we need a new dorm. And so they said, can we go down to the river where there's a lot of lumber available? Can we cut down some lumber and come back and build a bigger dormitory? And Elisha said, yeah, that's cool. And they're like, would you mind going with us and kind of overseeing the project? And Elisha said, sure, I'll go with you. Now, you could see all around us today kind of this idea of building. You know, we see this here. I had to scoot the crane over a little bit earlier because it was kind of over here. And I kind of felt like I would be tempted to punch that balloon a little bit, you know, like a little punching bag. Of course, at Vacation Bible School, we're talking about building this week with concrete and cranes. Well, here, they were going to build a dormitory, and they were going to the Jordan River to chop down some trees to do it. And it was kind of, it seems like every guy was responsible for a tree. You know, so they had a bunch of guys like, all right, time to earn your keep. Get out here, and everybody, you chop down a tree and bring back a beam, and we'll build the new dorm. And so that's what they did. They all went down there. But in the midst of doing this, one of them, His axe, the head of the axe, fell off, and he was upset because he had borrowed it. Can you imagine him returning that to you like, hey, thanks for letting me borrow that axe. Here's the handle. That's the last time I'm going to let you borrow anything, right? But he had lost something. And rather than just continuing on as he had been, he recognized he had lost it and he needed to change something. So let's look this morning at this idea of lost and found, because maybe today you've lost something. Maybe today you're struggling. Maybe today you're feeling like, man, I wish I had what I used to have. I wish I was what I used to be. I wish, and maybe there's something lost today and you want to find it. So let's see three things from this passage. It was three things we could pull from here and use this guy as an example of how to find that which we have lost. The first thing we see is you've got to recognize what is lost. Recognize what is lost. Listen, this guy is chopping a tree. He has an axe. We've all seen and probably used an axe before. All right. The part that does the chopping is the axe head, the part with the blade on it. And in the midst of chopping, that flew off. Now, that's a scary thing if that's ever happened to you, if that axe head flies off. It's especially, you know, troublesome, though, for him. He was by the Jordan River. And so when it flew off into the river. And all he kind of knew was kind of a general area. It's went in that area. There's no telling how deep the river was at that point. There's no telling how wide it was or how far out the axe head went. But it was far enough, it seems, that he didn't just wade right in and pick it up. Because, you know, that's what we would do if something fell off into the river or at the lake or something. If we knew the general area, I mean, we'd be over there. If it was not too deep with our hands, we'd be doing that. Or if you've ever lost anything at a beach or something, you're walking around shuffling your feet, hoping you bump into it. Wherever, however deep it was, however wide it was, wherever it went, apparently it was too far for him to be able to do that. Because he doesn't just jump in to find it. Instead, he cries out for Elisha. But the first thing he did, he recognized he had lost something. He recognized something was wrong. He recognized that his ability to chop down the tree had been hindered because the tool that he had to do it had been lost. He recognized that what he was called to do, he could not do. Can you imagine if he had just denied that there was a problem? If he had just kept on chopping? I have an axe handle here that I picked up some time ago because I think I had an axe head laying around that I was going to use, and I think I ended up putting it on a shorter handle and didn't use this one. But can you imagine the guy out there swinging and that axe head flies off, but he just keeps on chopping? If any of the other guys are standing around chopping down a tree and they see him just swinging that axe handle, bang, bang, bang. Don't you think they'd have stopped and be like, what's that dummy doing? My goodness. Yo, watch this. What? Let's see how long it takes to chop down that tree. I'm like, maybe they're leaning on their axes, you know. Yeah, yeah. Keep going. Chop a little harder. You're almost there. I mean, that's what you would have done, right? If the Joker just kept on pounding away at a tree, and you know, all he would have done was just made a little dent. He wouldn't have chopped down that tree, no matter how long he worked, no matter how hard he swung, because he had lost the most important thing. It wasn't the handle that was the most important. It was that the axe head. And so he had to be honest. He had to recognize, I've lost something. There's something in my life that isn't there anymore. There's something that I used to have that gave me the ability to do what God had called me to do, but it's gone now. He had to recognize what was lost. Maybe today you feel like you've lost something. Again, maybe you feel like you've lost your joy. You've lost your peace. You've lost the power that God has given you to do His will. You've lost that zeal for Him. You've lost that love. Or maybe you've lost that direction. And then maybe you say today, I just feel lost. Like something's missing. Something I used to have. Something that I wish I had again. But it's just not the same anymore. I've lost something. I think there's a lot of people struggling with that idea today. A lot of people feeling lost in our current environment. A lot of people feeling like, I just don't have direction. I don't know what I'm supposed to do. I don't know where I'm supposed to go. I'm not sure how all this is supposed to work. I just feel lost. Maybe there was a time where you used to love to come to church and read your Bible and pray, and you loved all of that, and now it's kind of, man, it's a pain. It's a drudgery. It's not as easy as it used to be because you've lost something. As I said, you may not know right away what is missing, but you just know something's missing. You may need to ask for help. The man who lost the axe head, he called to the prophet. He called Elisha. Alas, I've lost something, and it was borrowed. For you and I, we need to call out to God and say, God, something's changed. God, I used to be so close to you. God, I used to have this fire and this passion for you. And God, I've grown cold. Hey, I know it's not you, God, because you're the same yesterday, today, forever. You are the Lord. You change not. So if something's changed, it's not you. I know it's me. But God, what is it? What have I lost? Why is it that I'm not as close to you as I used to be? Why is it that I'm struggling when used to, it was so easy to serve you? Why? What's missing, God? What have I lost? And listen, God's not, you know, oh, no, no. Good luck with that. I'm not going to help you. Listen, if we go to God asking for help, asking for wisdom, asking for direction, He's going to give it. He's not going to hide that from us. And so when you've lost something, recognize, one, I've lost something. And God, I need help finding out. If you don't know what it is, God, I need help. Something's changed and I need help. Maybe you also need to reach out to someone you can trust, someone who is mature that can help you through that. You know, man, I used to be so close, but now I seem so far from God. Help me. Help me pray about that. What have I lost? Just like with the guy with the missing axe head, though, if you're going to recover what was lost, you have to be honest with yourself that something's missing. It doesn't do you any good to just keep going through the motions. Man, I don't seem to have the power of God on my life anymore. I don't have peace. I don't have direction. But I'm just going to keep on banging my head against the wall. Keep on trying, because eventually something's going to happen, right? Eventually something's going to change, right? Listen, if something's missing in your life, you've got to be honest and say, I've lost something. I need something. As foolish as it would have been for the guy to keep chopping the tree without the axe head, the same is true of the believer who keeps trying to just go their own way, go and do something, hoping that something will please God when they don't have direction or power or love or zeal for God. I considered some of these thoughts. It's hard to be the light of the world if you've lost your joy. It's hard to tell people that they can have peace in difficult seasons if you've lost your peace. It's hard to direct people to the Savior if you've lost your direction. It's hard to stand up in times of trial if you've lost your power. It's hard to see the need of the world for Jesus Christ if you've lost your passion for Him. It's hard to share the love of Jesus with the lost and dying world if you've lost your love for Him. It's hard to help others find what God wants them to be if you seem to have lost yourself. Sometimes things that are lost aren't necessarily our fault. Sometimes it is our fault. Sometimes we've done something. Have you ever been driving down the road and maybe you're just singing a song, or maybe you're on the phone, or maybe it's a trip and you're playing some sort of road game with the kids, you know, I spy with my little eye, and you're so busy spying that you missed your turnoff. And you go an hour down the road and you're like, man, I really feel like we should have turned off before. Now, where are we? And you recognize you're lost and it was your fault because you weren't paying attention. But then maybe in another scenario, you're driving and the GPS says, turn left at such and such a road. And you know that she's saying it's right there, only there's no road there anymore. You can tell there's been road work recently and the road is gone. Well, what do I do now? Now you just try to find the next closest road and make that turn and hope that that gets you where you need to go. You're lost, but it's not your fault. And listen, sometimes we lose our way in life and it's all because of us. We took our eyes off of God. We stopped reading His Word. We chose the world over Him. And it's our fault and we're lost. We still need to find what we lost. We still need to return. Then there's other times something's happened around us or to us. These last few months, I mean, hey, it's been crazy. If folks have lost their direction in these last few months, it's not necessarily because they did anything. It could be because of what they've had to go through. And so we see that sometimes it's our fault. Sometimes it's not. But I see and hear it all the time. See it on social media, folks just struggling, folks feeling directionless and lost, folks lacking peace but having plenty of fear right now. It's not just this year, but man, especially this year. Like 2020 has been, you know, craziness on steroids. I mean, it is just any crazy year you can think of, multiply it by several times and welcome to 2020. It's been that kind of year. And every few weeks, it seems like it's something different. So folks are struggling like never before. Folks are stressing like never before. What's next? Where do we go from here? Why can't we just go back to normal? What if something else happens next? And we see folks that are struggling, that are lost. But listen, if you want to get to the found of lost and found, first you got to recognize what is lost. Recognize what is lost. The guy said, hey, the axe head flew off. I've lost it. Elisha, can you help me? That's the first step, recognize. Second thing, remember where you last had it. When the man told Elisha he had lost the axe head, see what Elisha asked him, where fell it? In other words, where did you last see it? Or like that question that, you know, someone will ask you, well, where did you lose it? That's what he was asking him. Where did you last have it? Where did you lose the axe head? Where do we need to start looking? And listen, the man pointed out he didn't know the exact spot. You know, in a river, you can't point, it's right there, that spot. He just said it's kind of in that area. He knew the general area of where he last had the axe head. He knew the general area of where it had flown into the river. And so he knew that he could start. And listen, it may be that you know the general area where that feeling of being lost came upon you. That peace that you used to have that was so powerful, you kind of lost it. That power that you had to do great things for God, you lost it. And maybe you don't remember exactly the day. Maybe it wasn't a single day. Maybe it was over a period of time. One thing after another happened and you started to feel something's changed. I've lost something. And so you may not be able to point to one particular day, one particular thing that happened, but you can remember back, hey, I remember the last time I really felt the peace of God in my life. I remember the last time I really felt joy at living for God. I remember the last time, man, I really felt in love with Christ. And you know, it's been a little while. You know, it was before this thing happened and somehow things changed. You got to remember where you last had it. Get back, think back to that time when you last remember having those things in your life. Remember back to when it was easy to live for God, when it was easy to come to church. You look forward to it every single time the doors were open, when it was easy to read your Bible, when it was easy to pray. What's changed from then till now when you feel like something is lost. I know there are some folks struggling today who used to be faithful to church but hadn't been in a while. I know there's folks that you know, it used to seem easy. And if they were honest, though, the last time things were going well was when they were reading God's Word and when they were faithful to church and when they were able to fellowship with other believers, just like we talked about for a number of weeks recently, how that we build each other up, how that we're to be here for each other and we're to encourage each other. Hey, the last time some people felt the peace of God and the love and the passion was when they were around other believers, but they chose to walk away. Maybe you've been in that situation. You've got to remember where you last had it. So if you're going to get to the found part of lost and found, you've got to recognize that you lost something. You've got to remember where you last had it. And then let's finish up with the third thing. So you've recognized something's lost in your life. You want to get it back. You want to go back to the way things were. You've remembered where you last had it and know where to look for it. So then what? Well, it's time to recover what was lost. Elijah said, Where was it? Where did it fall? The guy told him, and it says here that Elisha cut down a stick and threw it in thither, and the iron did swim. By the way, that's not normal, okay? That was the power of God, because you know the axe head should not have floated. So he threw a stick in, and just how sometimes we read the Bible, and God works in different ways in different situations. And that time he kind of whispered to Elisha, hey, throw in a stick and this will blow their mind. Watch this. Trust me. And he throws a stick in the river and that axe head starts to float. But that wasn't the end of it, was it? Right then he just had a floating axe head. He then said, therefore said he, take it up to thee. And he put out his hand and he took it. Hey, it wasn't enough that Elisha did his part. The man who lost it had to do his part. He had to recover what was lost. And listen, for us, it's not enough just to recognize we lost something. We recognize something's missing in our life. We've got to go and recover it. We've got to go and get it. We've got to go and search for it. We've got to go to God and say, God, I'm missing something. I don't have that peace. And again, I keep listing five or six things just because these are the ones that I thought of. Maybe it's something different for you. And so maybe I haven't said your thing yet, but there's something else you're thinking, man, I'm just missing this. I feel lost in this area. Whatever it is for you, whatever it is that's lost, hey, take it to God. But when He points you in the right direction, gives you guidance of how to recover it, then it's up to you to go and recover. Consider David, King David. After his sin with Bathsheba, because of his sin, he lost some things. And as we read in Psalm 51, he recognized there were some things that he had lost and he took it to God. Psalm 51 verses 1 through 14 say this, have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness, according unto the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgressions. He knew he had sinned. He wasn't trying to deny it. He knew he had lost that close fellowship with God, that relationship with Him because of his sin. He knew it was his fault. And he said, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. Man, David here, he's not a guy trying to make excuses. He's not a guy trying to make light of what he had done. He recognized, look at it, iniquity, transgressions, sin. I mean, he's not holding anything back. He's not saying, hey, God, would you forgive me? I transgressed your commandments. I sinned against you. My iniquity is before me. He's clear about that. And he keeps on, against thee and thee only have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified when thou speakest and be clear when thou judgest. Hey, God, if you strike me down right now, I earned it. Hey, God, I lost, you know, in David's situation, he's like, I lost my child. I deserve that. Anything you do to me, God, I earned it. It's on me. I sinned against you. So he's being honest. He recognizes what he lost. He recognizes why he lost it. He recognizes where it was he lost it. It was because of that sin, that relationship you and I had, that sin. That's when I lost it. But he doesn't stop there. Behold, I was shapen in iniquity and in sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, thou desirest truth in the inward parts and in the hidden part. Thou shalt make me to know wisdom. Purge me with hyssop and I shall be clean. Wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. Make me to hear joy and gladness, that the bones which thou hast broken may rejoice. Hide thy face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities. Hey, all that he's asking here is, hey, whatever punishment has to come, let it come. But let it come so that I can be restored. Let it come so that I can get back that which I was, which I lost. Don't hold this against me forever. Deal with me, punish me. But then, God, I want a renewed relationship with you. I want to be back to what was lost. And look what he says, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence. Take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. God, I've lost my joy because of my sin. Will you help me find that joy again? Will you restore that joy again? Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation and uphold me with thy spirit. Then will I teach transgressors thy ways, and sinners shall be converted unto thee. David wanted to be restored and renewed. He wanted God's forgiveness. He knew where he had lost the peace and the joy and the passion and the love that he had for God. He knew where he had lost his direction. He knew where he had lost his relationship with God. And he said, hey, I want to get back to that. God, will you restore me? Will you help me to find that which I've lost? Will you help me to restore that which I used to have? Whenever I used to find it so easy to go to your house. When I used to find it so easy to talk to you, God. When I used to, on my mouth at all times, were praise for you. I want to get back to that. I wonder if you can identify with that. I wonder if you can identify with a place where once upon a time you were closer to God than you are now. And you remember with fond memories, man, I remember how good that was. I remember how sweet that was. I remember the joy that filled me, the peace that just flooded my soul when I was so close to my Lord. And I want to get back there. I just feel so lost. Listen, God wants you to come back. He wants you to be restored. He wants you to recover that which you've lost. Here's just a few passages, and I seriously, these are just three or four passages from God's Word where He calls to His people to come back, to recover what was lost. It's Jeremiah 24:7. He says, I will give them an heart to know me that I am the Lord, and they shall be my people, and I will be their God, for they shall return unto me with their whole heart. That idea of returning, that's recovering that which was lost. Because remember, God didn't move. We have to return to Him. We have to go back to Him where we lost that which we had. Isaiah 44:22, I have blotted out as a thick cloud thy transgressions, and as a cloud thy sins. Return unto me, for I have redeemed thee. In Malachi, I've mentioned Malachi a number of times over the last couple years. In Malachi, God, here at the end of the Old Testament, God is rebuking His people because time and time and time again, God had delivered them. Time and time and time again, He had shown them what they should do. Time and time and time again, He had shown Himself faithful. But yet, continually, they strayed. Continually, they did the wrong thing. And in Malachi, he talks about the people. He talks about the preachers. He talks about husbands and wives. He talks about the kids. Like he talks about all of the nation, how they have strayed. And in the midst of that, when he is rebuking them, he says this, even from the days of your fathers, ye are gone away from mine ordinances and have not kept them. Return unto me, and I will return unto you, saith the Lord of hosts. But ye said, wherein shall we return? I know I've mentioned in the past, there's I think it's 7 or 8 times in the book of Malachi where God gives a statement, and rather than heeding it and listening to it and obeying it, the people bring back a question. But not a question like, well, Lord, can you clarify? Can you give us direction? How do we do this? We really sincerely want to know. God makes a statement and they say, what? No way. God, are you serious? No, you're mistaken, God. This is one of those. He says, return unto me. Come back. Let's get back to that relationship that we've lost because of your sin. Return to me. And they're like, what are you talking about, return to you? We haven't gone anywhere. God, the creator and sustainer of the entire universe, is telling them they've strayed. And they're saying, nah, not me. Nah, I'm good. This is where I'm supposed to be. This is how I'm supposed to be living. That sounds like us when we're being stubborn and rebellious, doesn't it? Hey, God, you got that wrong. I'm doing okay. I'm good. There's nowhere that I need to return. There's nothing I need to recover. There's nothing I've lost, God. You obviously have changed. But the God doesn't change. So we see in Malachi, he says, return to me. Revelation chapter 2, speaking to the first of the 7 churches there that are referenced in Revelation, he praises them for some things, but then in verse 4, he says, nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee because thou hast left thy first love. We might could also say they've lost their first love. You don't love me like you used to. You're not on fire for me like you used to be. You've lost your first love. So what does he say to them? I'm done with you. Too bad. I'm casting you out, right? No. Remember, therefore, from whence thou art fallen. Repent and do the first works, or else I will come unto thee quickly and will remove thy candlestick out of his place, except thou repent. Repent, return, go back to that which you had lost. Do it again, that love that you used to have for me. Go back to that. I want you to love me like you used to love me. We see many times God wants us to return. He wants us to find that which we've lost in our relationship with Him, whatever it may be. Whether it's one of the things I've mentioned today or something completely different that you say, man, I'm missing what I used to have. He wants us to be a distinct, different people in this world. He wants His followers to look and act and sound like His followers should. He wants us to be close to Him and calls us to remember, repent, return, and recover. If you're going to get to the found part of lost, you have to remember or recognize that you've lost something. You've got to recognize or remember where you last had it, and you've got to recover what you lost. As we close, I want you to think about your life, not the person sitting next to you. Yeah, you know, they used to be closer to God. They've really strayed. Now listen, hey, this is for you. Was there a time in your life where you were closer to Him? Was there a time in your life where you had more peace than you do now? Have you drifted? Is there something lost right now and you want it to be found? Hey, God says, return. Recognize you've lost something. Don't just keep pounding away. I'm just going to keep trying. I'm going to try harder. I don't have the peace, the power, the love, the passion. I don't have any of that, but I'm just going to keep trying. I'm going to keep trying to chop down this tree. I'm going to keep trying to live for God in my own power. Now you've got to recognize something's missing. Recognize you've lost something. Realize that it's got to be gotten again. You've got to find it. Realize that, hey, there was a time when I had this love or passion or whatever for God that I've lost. You know, I remember where it was that I lost it the last time I had it. And then go and get it. Recover that. Confess that to God. God, I've lost that passion for you. I've lost that zeal for you, that power that you used to have. God, it's on me. It ain't your fault. It's on me. Forgive me of that, please. And we've talked about repentance a number of times in the last few weeks. And I'll give this illustration again. The word repent, which is throughout the Word of God, it means to turn from one thing and turn to another. And the reason many of us feel lost at different times is because we've turned from God and we're pursuing after whatever the world has to say, whatever the world has to give. And listen, sometimes it's not a good thing. It's not that, oh man, I'm just pursuing after the riches of the world. That may be your thing, but it might be, hey, I'm just listening to all the garbage the world has to say. All the fear that they're pumping into me, I'm just listening to that and I'm just soaking it up. And if there's something negative on the news, man, I've heard it and I've read it in 15 different places and I'm just soaking it in, soaking it in. Listen, sometimes we got to repent for listening to the wrong voices. And repent, this is what I've been saying recently. Repent means to turn from one thing to another. It's a 180, okay? Hey, I'm listening to the world. I'm following the world. I've lost all my joy, my peace, my power, because I'm all about what is the world telling me I got to do? Repent means to turn from that and turn back to God. You want to restore the peace that you used to have? Stop listening to the world and listen to the Word of God. Listen to the Lord speaking to you. Follow His Spirit. You want to restore that passion that you used to have for seeing lost people come to Jesus Christ? Stop listening to the world. Stop serving those things in the world and follow after Jesus Christ. Read His Word. Get in His Word. Pray. Seek His face. He wants to be found. He's not hiding to where you won't ever find Him. We need to repent and return. Repent and return. We need to remember what we've lost, repent, return, and then recover. Now, as we close, if there's anyone here that's never accepted Jesus as their Lord and Savior, if you've never come to that moment where you recognize that you are a sinner and cannot save yourself, the Bible says that your sin has condemned you to an eternity in a very real place called hell. If you've never come to recognize that, if you've never come to a place where you saw yourself as a sinner and knew you needed a Savior, if you've never come to the place where you've seen what the Word of God has to say, that God loved you so much that He sent Jesus to die for you and to take the punishment for your sins, if you've never come to that place and you've never accepted that He died for you, then listen, You are what's lost. In every way possible, you are lost and separated from God. But the good news is, Jesus Christ said Himself, I came not to seek those that are well or need no physician. He said that He came to seek and to save that which was lost. If you're lost today, if you don't know Jesus as your Savior, listen, today you can get that taken care of. You don't have to put it off. You don't have to clean up your life. Listen, if you say, well, I just got to get some things out of my life first before I come to Jesus. I've got to straighten up some stuff before I come to Jesus. If you're going to run your car through the car wash, do you wash it at home first? You're like, no, that'd be dumb, right? Why would I waste money on a car wash if I'm just going to wash it at the house? Yeah, that would be dumb. Why do you think you need to clean yourself up before you go to Jesus, who's going to give you forgiveness of your sins and clean you eternally and take off your rags of unrighteousness and put on you His robe of righteousness? What makes you think that you could straighten yourself up in any way to be presentable to God? The Bible says that all of our righteousnesses, that means all the best things we've ever done, are like filthy rags before Christ. So, hey, you can wash up those filthy rags and they're still going to be filthy. You can polish up yourself and do some good works and you're still going to be filthy before God. It's only through the cleansing of Jesus Christ that you can have your sins forgiven and you can be made right with Him. And so maybe today it's not that you've lost your peace or joy. Maybe it's you are lost and you need a Savior. And He's saying, hey, come unto Me. Come unto Me. I love you so much. I'm willing to forgive you. I'm willing to heal you. And I'm willing to receive you into my family for all of eternity. What is it that's lost today? Let's pray. Lord, thank You for Your word. Thank You for this story in 2 Kings of the man who lost the axe head. Lord, I realize there may be someone in here who's lost something. Maybe they're just feeling lost. They don't have any direction or their passion, their peace or love or joy or any number of things. They've lost them. They remember a time when they were closer to You. They remember a time when there was a fire and a passion for You. They remember a time when they could pray and feel that peace and they say that something has changed. God, we know You haven't moved. If we're feeling lost in some area today, it's because of us. We've moved. Help us to be real about that and recognize what we've lost. Help us to remember where we last had it so we can go back. Hey, I remember where I was. I remember how I was living. I remember how close I was to the Lord. And I was constantly in His Word when I used to have that overwhelming peace. I remember that passion I had for Him. And it's when I was faithful to His church. God, help us to remember where we were. And then not stop there. Help us to recover what we lost. Help us to go back and pick it back up. Help us to go back and recover. Start living for You again if that's what we need. But maybe there's someone here today that it's not a thing they've lost. It's not a feeling they've lost, but rather they are lost. Jesus came to seek and to save that which was lost. You loved us so much You sent Jesus to die for our sins. If there's someone here that's never accepted Jesus as their Lord and Savior, God, I pray that You would make them miserable today. Miserable until they come to the realization, look, I need a Savior and I've got to give my life to Jesus. I pray that they might cry out to You today, recognizing that they are a sinner and need a Savior. Lord, I pray that Your will would be done today in each and every heart. I pray that each one of us would be honest with You and honest with ourselves. Maybe we're not where we used to be, but we sure want to be. I pray that we'd be honest about that. God, have Your will and way in this invitation. In Jesus' name. Amen.